Amen. Giving glory to the Spirit of God, who is the head of this house, the head of my life. I don't know about yours, but everything I do, He rules and reigns, because He alone is the all-powerful, the matchless, the all-knowing, the supreme being. And He's given us a name Jesus, for that name is given among men whereby we must, not should, not perhaps, but must be saved. Also want to bring greetings, greet our pastor and his wife. In their absence, Apostle Andrew S. Henry and his wife, Evangelist Julie Artuso. So I want to greet Evangelist Wilson, Missionary Wright, Sister Tasha, Brother Pastor Future Cliff. Amen. And all the saints of the Most High God. Just turn to someone and give them a great big hug and say, I'm glad to see you today. And when you do it, don't lie in the house of God. So if you're not really glad to see them, then don't hug them and say you're glad to see them. Amen? Amen. So while you're seated, if you would, I'm going to ask you to follow along with me in Ephesians chapter 3. We're going to read verses 1 to 13. And I'm going to allow you to sit because I'm going to read it in the New Living Translation. Amen. Sometimes when we sit and we listen, we follow, we get the word more. Amen? So I'm going to read it. If you have it, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. If you don't have it, say hold on. Okay, we're waiting. We're going to wait for everyone so we get it together. Amen.
Amen.
As I read. It says, when I think of all this, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus for the benefit of you Gentiles, assuming, by the way, that you know God gave me the special responsibility of extending His grace to you Gentiles. As I briefly wrote earlier, God Himself revealed His mysterious plan to me. As you read what I have written, you will understand my insight into this plan regarding Christ. God did not reveal it to previous generations, but now by His Spirit. Someone say, by His Spirit.
By His Spirit.
But now by His Spirit, He has revealed it to His holy apostles and prophets. And this is God's plan. Both Gentiles and Jews who believe. Someone say, believe. Both Gentiles and Jews who believe the good news share equally in the riches inherited by God's children. Both are part of the same body, and both enjoy the promise of blessings because they belong to Christ Jesus. By God's grace and mighty power, I have been given the privilege of serving Him by spreading this good news. Though I am the least deserving of all God's people, He graciously gave me the privilege of telling the Gentiles about the endless treasures available to them in Christ. I was chosen to explain to everyone this mysterious plan that God, the creator of all things, had kept secret from the beginning. God's purpose in all this was to use the church to display His wisdom in its rich variety to all the unseen rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was His eternal plan, which He carried out through Christ Jesus our Lord. Because of Christ and our faith in Him, we can now come boldly and confidently into God's presence. So please don't lose heart because of my trials here. I am suffering for you, so you should feel honored. Amen. Before we go any further, I'm going to ask everyone just to rise to our feet. I'm going to ask Missionary Wright to lead us in prayer that the Lord's will be done.
Father eternal, our King, our Savior, Lord, truly you are wonderful, you're awesome, you're excellent, you're great, Lord Jesus. God Almighty, Lord, we're here because we need a word from you, Lord Jesus. We're here because we need from you, oh God. Lord, let us, oh God, hear your download in our spirit, oh God. Lord, we ask that you use, oh God, for the one who you've set for today, oh God, this moment, this time, oh God. Download in her spirit according to your will, oh God. Your word, put it in her, Lord God. Let it come forth, oh God, and bring forth fruit in each and every one of us. Let us hear, let us receive the word that you've given through your main servant, oh God. In the name of Jesus Christ, oh God, we glorify you, we give you all honor and praise. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Before you're seated, just find, I was going to say three people, but we'll compromise, we'll make it four. Amen. Shake four people's hand and tell them or ask them, why am I here? Why am I here? Why am I here? You may be seated in Jesus' name this morning. As the Lord leads, want to impress and deliver this thought, this pressing notion that the Lord has been dealing with me for some time now. And before we go any further, I want to give you a definition. And if you're taking notes, like I said, we're going to be expedient this morning, so this is a good thing to write down. The definition is of the word purpose. It's an intention, a wish, or a feat one has in mind and means to carry out for a particular end. It's a driving force or reason behind action, a plan, a settled determination. I'll read that in your hearing again. Purpose, an intention, wish, or feat one has in mind and means to carry out for a particular end. The driving force or reason behind action, a plan, a settled determination. And so when Paul was speaking to the Ephesians in chapter 3, as we read, Paul had been thinking about all that he had spoken. As you know, Paul was writing this letter to the Ephesians, to the church at Ephesus. And when Paul had reflected on all that he'd been talking about and all that he'd reflected on, he came to this conclusion. He said, when I think of all this, me, Paul, I can't speak for anybody else, but me, based on my experience as a prisoner of Christ Jesus, but not a prisoner for no reason. See, Paul was talking about his place as being shackled, as being restrained. Someone say restrained. He was restrained for a particular purpose, and his purpose was for the benefit of the Gentiles. For as you know from reading the text, we won't get into the depths of it right now, but we know that after the Holy Ghost has come and poured out upon all flesh, as it was prophesied, the church had spread. And so people, even though they were persecuted, the persecution was for a purpose. Everyone say purpose. And the purpose was so that the gospel, this good news that the church had heard, would spread, would go to the uttermost parts of the earth. And so Paul, even though Paul comes into the equation a little later, he said, I, a prisoner, I've been shackled. My whole life has been constrained for a particular purpose. And that purpose or that intention, that wish or that feat that he had in mind and meant to carry out was for the particular end that the Gentiles hear this great gospel. For if you know the story, as you read in the text, before this time, the Jews had exclusive rights, if you will, to the truth. The Jews had the exclusive rights to be the chosen one of Israel. They were God's chosen people. But even if you understand Israel's place, they weren't just chosen because they were so special, but they were special because they were chosen. And they were chosen because they were to stand as an example to the people, so that when the fullness of time came and this great mystery that Paul spoke about was revealed, that people could say, ah, I get it. And people could walk, because the Old Testament was our schoolmaster. In other words, it was our teacher to teach us the way that we ought to go. So Paul, when he's considering all this, he says, you know, I've been shackled. My whole life has been imprisoned or restrained for this particular reason, that it benefit these Gentiles. And he says, just assuming, he says, you know, when I'm saying these things, I'm assuming that you already understand that God has given me this special responsibility. Someone say responsibility. Responsibility. Paul understood that God had given him a special responsibility to speak and to edify and to encourage and to declare the truth of this word to the Gentiles. So that means that everything that Paul did was focused on this particular purpose. Everything that Paul experienced was focused on this particular purpose of relating to the special responsibility extended to the Gentiles. And so what Paul is saying is that everything in my life, because I'm a prisoner, and if you hear me repeating something, it's because it's important. I want to drive this into our spirits this morning. Everything that Paul experienced was because he was a prisoner and restricted for this particular purpose. So that means every day and every moment and every experience that Paul encountered was all for a purpose. Someone say purpose.
Purpose.
And so Paul is speaking from his place of experience. He says, you know, as I wrote to you earlier, God has revealed his mysterious plan to me. So by revelation, Paul got an understanding of this plan that God had from before the foundation of the world. And he says, listen, if you would just listen to what I'm saying, I'm not just speaking out of left field here, but everything I'm saying to you is being directed by God, because he's given me this understanding, this revelation to understand the pieces. Because, you know, in the Old Testament, you've got pieces. The Old Testament was to be a type and a shadow. And so it's pieces of a greater puzzle. But when you just see the individual pieces, you don't get the whole picture. But when finally all those pieces come together, you have that aha moment. You're like, oh, I get it. Revelation. And that's what revelation is. But you have to understand that revelation is progressive. We don't just get one piece and see one picture, because you see there's multiple. Oh God, I wish I could delve into it this morning. But you see that the multiple fold wisdom of God is not just for one purpose, but it serves a multitude of purposes that only, maybe that's why I love that song that says, we'll understand it better by and by, because only when all is said and done will we really understand everything that God has allowed. So Paul is speaking from this place of experience. He said, listen, I'm telling you all this because God has given me this revelation, this insight, and that's why I'm speaking it to you, because you've got to understand this. He said, here is God's plan. So he set it up. He said, this is the plan. Both Gentiles and Jews who believe. Someone say believe.
Believe.
Both Gentiles and Jews who believe the good news, they share equally in the riches inherited by God's children. Because the Bible says that them that are led by the Spirit are sons of God. So what Paul is saying is that it doesn't matter, you know, we know the history, we know that Israel was God's chosen people, but they were chosen for a purpose, to demonstrate what God does for them that are his own. So what he's saying is that all that you saw, God's hand of protection over Israel, his keeping them, all that is a benefit that is equally shared with you, even if you were a Gentile dog, even if the Jews in their mindfulness thought that you were nothing and you didn't deserve this gospel. It didn't matter, because what he was saying is that, listen, this gospel is for you. And you share equally. In other words, there's no, you know, no one better than you, no one worse off you, but we all share equally in this gospel. And so as you see Paul, he's methodically breaking down the words so that the people can understand. Why? Because there is an inherent, an important understanding that as becoming children of God, we must understand. First, you've got to believe. You must believe. If you don't believe, you know, you can come to church every day. The doors are open. You can be the first one here and the last one to leave. You can know every scripture from front to back, upside down. So you can know everything that there is to know. But if you do not believe, then you disinherit yourself. And if you disinherit yourself, then it doesn't matter what you've done. Because it's not by works, lest any man should boast. But it's because it is in God's will. And so Paul, understanding this, he realized that, my God, this is a privilege that I've been granted to be able to share this message. And he said, it has absolutely nothing to do with me. I'm the least of God's people. You know, born out of due season. You know, I was the one who was persecuting the children of God. I was the one who was persecuting them who were spreading this very gospel that I'm now, my life has been given over to. So he says, it's not because of anything I've done. It's not because of any great plan I've concocted. But it's only because God has graciously, by his grace, that is more than sufficient for anything, to cover anything. He says, by this grace, he gave me this privilege of telling the Gentiles about these endless treasures that are available to them and are available to us through Christ. He said, I was chosen to explain to everyone this mysterious plan that God, the creator of all things, has kept secret. For the secrets of God are reserved for them that love him. And them that love him are those who keep his commandments. So if you keep his commandments, he gives you that benefit of having these secrets and these mysteries that no one else knows, that are hidden, that even the angels desire to look into and desire to understand what's going on. And so what Paul, as he's getting this understanding, he says God's purpose. Everyone say purpose. And if you remember our definition of purpose, is that intention, a wish or feat one has in mind and means to carry out for a particular end. So what he's saying is that God's intention in all that he's done, hear this now, God's intention in everything that he's done was to use the church. Someone say, that's me. Amen. Was to use the church to display his wisdom in its rich variety to all the unseen rulers and authorities in heavenly places. So in other words, God is using us in the sum total of what he's done from before creation up until now for all that is going to be done. He's using all of that in this body called the church to be able to show those celestial beings in heavenly places, those rulers, the things that we can't see with our natural eye. He's using everything to display to them his wonder. For the Bible says that all things are created for his purpose and for his good pleasure. So pretty much God can do whatever he wants, whatever he desires. But in everything that God does, he has purpose. Someone say purpose. He has intent. There's a reason behind everything that God does. And he said, even this creation, the whole, you know, oftentimes I used to ask the Lord, why this whole plan? You know, really, you know, sometimes you really just have to level with God and be, Lord, really? You are God. Now, really, you're God. The Bible says we live and move and have our being in you. So if you can do anything you wanted to, why would you subject yourself to your own law, come and suffer and die? No, really, come. Has anyone else ever thought about this? I mean, if you are God, you can. All he had to do was speak things into existence, and they are. So all he had to do was speak us into existence, and we would be. So why go through all the effort and the energy and the time to create this whole elaborate plan? Come on. And we get part of the intel here. It's to demonstrate his multifold wisdom. Amen. That's why the angels desire to look into this, because they can't understand it. Because they're saying the same thing, but like, what is man? These little dirt beings, less than microscopic in the grand scheme of the heavens and the earth, and that you desire to dwell with the Lord. Lord, we know you're not crazy, so obviously there must be some kind of purpose, but God, we can't figure this out. You have all the angels worshiping you night and day, whole crying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, and you would leave the splendors of heaven and descend into the same place you created and have the ones that you created that are nothing, have them spit on you and castrate you and say all manner of things and beat you and kill you. The angels, they can't comprehend it. They can't understand this is the Lord. You know, Lord, this is too wonderful for me. I can't figure this one out. But he did it to show his manifest wisdom. And this is the plan. This was his eternal plan. So from before he started anything, before he spoke into existence, before he, you know, what the Bible says, in the beginning was the heaven and the earth. But I always wonder, so what happened before the beginning? Yeah, the beginning is a time point. And it's a specific point in time. But God doesn't dwell in time. So what was going on before this beginning? There was intention and there was purpose. Before the beginning, there was purpose and intent. And the Lord moved upon the face of the water to be able to bring forth his purpose and his intent so that all things would work together for good according to his plan. So Paul goes on to say, and he's I can just imagine Paul getting excited as he's, because when you start to get an understanding of what God is saying, you just, I don't know about you, but I get excited. So I'm like, wow, wow. When you really start to get into it, you say, wow, God is, it's just mind-blowing. He's beyond words. There aren't words to clearly articulate the brilliance and the, I tell God all the time, I said, Lord Jesus, you're a genius. And genius doesn't even begin to, it doesn't even kind of like, you know, it's limited. You know, there's no, he knows everything and set everything for his good pleasure just because he wants to. Just because. So Paul says, so given this body of information, now that I've told you all of this, now you can understand, now that we've got that faith or that trust, now because we trust God, we trust Christ, we can come boldly and confidently into his presence because we know if he's done all this, there is a reason for it. And so if he tells us to come boldly, boldly before his throne of grace that we may find help in time of need. It's because there's something that we must do that we need help with. Someone say, I need help. Amen. And not just any kind of help, but I need the help from one who comes from the all-knowing, who knows what purpose I am supposed to fulfill. But he says, because of that, we can now come boldly and confidently into God's presence. So he says, so please don't lose heart because of my trials here. Because if we, to go back to the beginning, everything I suffer, you know, at the end of his life, Paul talked about being shipwrecked, blues, forsaken by those who were closest to him, those he trusted, you know, by forsaken, being shipwrecked, stoned twice, naked often was I in the deep, fasting often. He said, but all this was all for the sake of bringing forth the purpose for which I've been shackled.
Amen.
And that purpose was to minister to the Gentiles so they could understand this great salvation. So he said, I'm suffering for you. I'm going through all this shipwreck and all the stoning and the castration and being, you know, chased from one city to another. I'm going through all of this for you. But he said, don't feel sorry for me, because this is what I'm called to do. Instead, you should feel honored that God would purpose me and would create a vessel through which receive this gospel. And it's with that thought that I come back to our title for the message this morning, Why Am I Here? Because it's great for us to talk about Paul and his purpose. And Paul knew of a certainty what he was called to do, because at the end he says, now, he said, I fought the good fight. I've kept the faith, and now there's reserved unto me a crown of righteousness, or a crown of obedience. In other words, the reward for being obedient has now been extended to me because I have done everything that God has purposed for me to do. So remember, he's talking about being shackled, about being imprisoned. So in other words, everything that I do, I have no choice in the matter. But everything that I do, everything that I am, everything I say, everything, every part of my being, even to my very thoughts, are for this particular purpose. And so I say all that this morning to get us to ask ourselves the question, why am I here? Because church, Paul is dead and gone. In this natural realm, Paul is gone. He accomplished his purpose. He did what he had to do. And now he's received his reward. And he's waiting for the rest of us to be perfected so that we as one body, as one church, can be presented before God.
Right.
So why am I here?
Right.
What is my purpose? So ask yourself, what is my purpose?
What is my purpose?
It's a question that we ask oftentimes in the church, but it's one that I'm afraid that we don't always wait or do what is required to find the answer for. Because the answer to this question has eternal ramifications. What do I mean by that? Well, first of all, purpose is determined by God. We're going to do a little bit of reading here. So we get Isaiah chapter 14, verse 26 and verse 27. And you hold your finger to Acts 26, 12 to 18. And I have them. So while you're looking, I'm just going to read them. Isaiah 14, 26 and 27, I'm reading from the Complete Jewish Bible, says, this is the program planned for all the earth. This is the hand stretched out over all the nations. Adonai Tzavot, or Adonai of hosts, has made his decision. Who is there that can stop him? He has stretched out his hand. Who can turn back? So in other words, whatever purpose God has designed for you, it is what it is, and there's nothing that you could do to change it. Whatever purpose God has designed for you, it is what it is, and there is nothing that you can do to change it. Whatever purpose, whatever intent, whatever purpose God has designed for you, whatever feat and whatever means that you were supposed to accomplish, it is what it is. It is forever settled in the heavens, and you cannot change it. It doesn't matter how much, like Paul, you try to kick against the pricks. And if you understand what that means, I was looking it up. He said you're kicking towards an ox goad. And if you see an ox goad, what it is a long stick with a hook and a very pointed end. And so when the men were plowing, if the ox weren't moving, they would poke them with the ox goad to make them move. But what would happen was the ox, oftentimes as a natural reaction, they would kick against it. But what happens when you kick against a sharp object? Thank you. You hurt yourself even more. Why? Because You're hitting against something that's inevitable, something that's sharp, that's going to keep poking you until you realize, you know what? Maybe I should just go. You know, maybe I should just be obedient. Maybe I should do, because the more you fight against it is the more it pokes you, the more it hurts you. So the more we fight against the purpose that God has intended for our lives, the more destruction you come against. Because if God's purpose that he's placed in your life is irrefutable and unchangeable, what do you think you're going to do to change it? No, really, church, let's be honest, because the time has come for us to put away just, you know, highfalutin ideas and get to the point. If God has ordained something for your life and he settled it from before the foundation of the world, what do you think you're going to do to change it? You know, Paul came and he was fighting against the church and fighting. And finally, when he got the revelation, he said, "Who art thou, Lord?" He said, "It is me, Jesus, whom thou persecutest." He said, it's hard for you to keep kicking against the brickies. It's hard for you to keep kicking against me, who's poking you, who's pushing you. See, all the things that Paul had endured in his life up until then, we just thought, oh, well, because he was a Pharisee and, you know, that's what they would do. No, but it was all purposed by God. So even the persecution, even the persecution of the saints was purposed by God. Because if you tell me that you are persecuting these saints, you are killing them, you will stop at nothing to destroy them, then all of a sudden you get a revelation, you're like, oh my God, and you do an about face, tell me that is not a testimony. Tell me that is not a declaration to say that, my God, there must be a God. And so that's why Paul, everywhere he went, I wish I had some help in this Catholic church this morning. It means everywhere that Paul went, whatever he said and he did, he preached his testimony. He said, listen, you can't be any worse off than I was. I persecuted, I killed, I took great joy in coming into the houses where the children of God were and killing them. And I didn't discriminate, man, woman, boy, girl, I didn't care. If they were preaching this gospel, I killed them. And I got orders and I did it zealously. If one like that can turn and say that Jesus Christ is Lord, and the very ones that I persecuted, I'm willing to put my life on the line and to preach that very same gospel that I was fighting against. And you tell me? Come on now, church. If you hear that testimony, it pricks you. Why? Because you realize that this is something that is beyond man. So purpose is determined by God. I got to get through this morning. But in order to find purpose, and I hope you're taking notes this morning, in order to find purpose, it requires obedience. Jeremiah chapter 6, verses 16 to 20. Here is what Adonai says. Stand at the crossroads and look. Ask about the ancient paths. Which one is the good way? Take it and you will find rest for your souls. But they said, we will not take it. I appointed sentinels to direct them. Listen for the sound of the shofar. But they said, we will not listen. So hear, you nations, know, you assembly, what there is against them. Hear, O earth, I am going to bring disaster on this people. It is the consequence. Someone say consequence. It is the consequence of their own way of thinking. I got to pause right there, because when I read that, the Lord just struck me. So many of us, now understand, there's situations that come and trials that come that are a consequence of obedience. Right. But there are also situations and trials that we bring upon ourselves that are a consequence of our own way of thinking. Right. And it's not because God is not with us, it's not because he has not directed us, but we think. You don't even have to say anything much beyond that, because we think, the minute you think, you're erred. Because if purpose is determined by God, then it doesn't matter what you think. It matters what God says. And whatever God says, you better do, or else there will be consequences of your own way of thinking. For they pay no attention to my words, and as for my Torah or my law, they reject it. So then what do I care about the incense from Shiva or sweet cane from a distant land? Your burnt offerings are unacceptable. Your sacrifices don't please me. The children of God thought they were doing well by offering sacrifices, but they forgot the purpose of what those sacrifices were for. The reason that the Lord gave such detail about what he wanted was so that the people could be drawn nigh unto him. But they got to a point where they were just doing just to do. They were just offering just because, and they didn't understand the purpose or the reason for their offering. So the Lord says, listen, you're offering sacrifices, but you're being disobedient. You're not listening to me. I'm telling you to move. I'm telling you to change, and you refuse to change. What then can you expect? Church, if we refuse to hear the word of God, it doesn't matter. You could be the holiest, holier than thou. It doesn't matter what you're, if you don't heed the word of God. There's going to be consequences. It doesn't matter what you think. It doesn't matter what your mother, grandmother, great-grandfather taught you. It matters what God said. Moving on. To avoid purpose equals destruction. Jeremiah 26, verses 1 to 6. I'll let you read that on your own. Jeremiah 26, 1 to 6. But no, to avoid purpose equals destruction. As we heard the children of Israel, how many times did the Lord plead to them, turn, 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 and they turned not. And so he left them to their own devices. He stood back in absentia, which is a powerful thought. We don't have time to get into it tonight, but to avoid purpose equals destruction. But on the flip side, when you walk in your purpose, right, it draws criticism. Uh-huh. Now, see, this is a hard one to understand because you think, okay, you're walking in your purpose. Everything should be good. Everything should be hunky-dory. But I heard a story about, you know, the woman. It's Matthew 26, verses 6 to 13. When Jesus has the home of Simon the leper, and this woman had an alabaster box filled with very expensive perfume, she approached Jesus while he was eating, began to pour it on his head. And all the disciples, someone say the church people.
Church.
All right. The church people saw it, and they became very angry, the Bible says. He said, why this waste? She was fulfilling her purpose, and they called it waste. She was fulfilling her purpose, and they called it a waste. These people who were supposed to be walking with Jesus, the ones who watched with them, talked with them, saw the great miracles, and they couldn't understand and say, why this waste? He said, there could have been sold for a lot of money and given to the poor. But Jesus, aware of what was going on, say aware.
Aware.
See, in order to know what your purpose is, you've got to be aware of what's happening around you. He says, why are you bothering this woman? She's done a beautiful thing for me. She poured this perfume on me to prepare my body for burial. She said, yes, I tell you that throughout the whole world, wherever this good news is proclaimed, what she has done will be told in her memory. If that was her only purpose for existence, she did it. In the face of every, the church people who criticized her, in the face of everything that stood against her, she said, I don't care. If this is my only purpose, then I'm going to pour my praise on him like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Because she had an understanding of purpose. We're moving on. Because purpose also involves timing. What Jesus said was so profound. He said, listen, she's doing this to prepare my body for burial. You know, after Jesus was gone, the disciples moaned and groaned and said, oh, and they were so moaning and groaning, but there was no reason for her to moan. Why? Because she had already accomplished the purpose for which she had done. So she didn't have to worry about after Jesus was dead, be like, oh God, I missed that opportunity. Church, purpose involves timing. Because there is a time under everything for, and every season. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 17. And the Bible says, I said to myself, the righteous and the wicked God will judge, because there is a right time. Everyone say right time. There is a right time for every purpose and for every action. So in other words, it's not just important to know what your purpose is, but you've got to understand the timing of your purpose, because a purpose carried out in a missed time is missed. And so your purpose is dependent on the timing. So if you don't get the timing right, then you miss. Because had she come after Jesus was dead, it would have defeated the purpose. It would have defeated the purpose. So timing is of the utmost importance. That being said, a lack of understanding of your purpose is a weakness. Romans 8, 26 to 28. It says that we know that all things work together for good to them that love God and who are the called according to his purpose. But if you don't know what your purpose is, you end up praying amiss. Because when the Lord is poking you with that ox goad like he did to Paul to push you into your purpose, you're saying, Lord, take me out, take me out, take me out. But the Lord said, no, you've got purpose and I got to bring it out of you. Lord, take me out, take me out. No, and he keeps poking him, and then finally he said, fine, dig you out. But then you're stuck in the same place where you were before. So all that was on the inside, that purpose that was intrinsic, because the next point is that purpose is intrinsic. It's not given, but it's already in you. That's why the Bible says your gifts will make room for you. Why? Because what God has already ordained for you to do, the tools that you need to accomplish it are already in you. That's why if you want to know what your purpose is, start with what you already know. Start with, you know, if you're a singer, just start singing. Just start singing. If that's your purpose, start singing, and you'll be amazed how doors will start to open. Yes. Why? Because your purpose, the tools that you need to accomplish that goal that God has for you, are already inside of you. Yes. That being said, purpose is not without pain. And as we see Jesus Christ, the ultimate example of knowing your purpose, as he was on the cross, he cried, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. In other words, God, why? Why have you forsaken me? I've done what I was supposed to do. I came and I spoke and I healed and I delivered. Why have you forsaken me? And God said nothing. Why? Because your purpose is not without pain. Pain is part of the process of bringing you to your purpose. Because he had to suffer through that pain, to suffer through the pangs of death, to be able to go down to the pit to grab the keys of death, hell, and the grave. But he understood that, and he gave up the ghost. Why? Because purpose should dictate everything you do. Your career, your job, your spouse, everything. Any decision is not your own, not by your own way of thinking, but purpose, your God-given purpose, not the purpose that you've conjured up in your mind that you think you should be doing because somebody came and told you that God said you must, but the purpose that is intrinsic in you that God has placed before the foundation of the world, that purpose must dictate everything that you do. Stand with me this morning. But when you walk in that purpose, that purpose will increase your confidence. For as we come back to the text that we started off with this morning, Paul said in those last verses, he says, because of Christ and our faith or our trust in him, we can now come boldly and confidently into God's presence. In other words, you come with the calm and said, Lord, you said, you said that you sent me to the Gentiles. Lord, you see the obstacles that are coming. You need to move because this is above and beyond what I'm able to do. But you are able to do exceedingly abundantly above anything I can ask or think. So Lord, thank you for the suffering. Thank you for the persecution. Thank you. It was good that I was afflicted because it brought me closer to that which you intended for me to do. So if you're wondering this morning how to get to purpose, if you follow the points that we've already spoken and you stir up that gift that's inside of you, as Paul said to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 6 to 10, he said, stir up the gift that's inside of you. Stir it up, because whatever's in you, God will use to accomplish his purpose. And while you're stirring up that gift, embrace the trial that you're going through or that you're about to go through, because it said that all things work together for good. That word good in the Hebrew means is tov. It means working as it should. So in other words, all things are working as it should for them that love God. Who are those who love God? The ones who keep his commandments. Who love God and who are the called according to his purpose. Because everyone in this house, he has called us for a purpose and given us all the tools that we need to be able to accomplish the purpose. Remember, many are called, but few are chosen. Because the chosen ones are the ones who say, as we sang, yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. See, as we started singing the song, the Lord said, you're setting the people up. And I said, yeah, we are. Because if you say yes, You got to do it. Amen. It's, as Evangelist said, it's a vow. Right. And you think about the words of the song, he said, yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes. Lord, yes, I will trust you. It means whatever you say, When you tell me to stand up in the middle of the street and yell and jump up five times, I don't understand it. But yes, Lord. Lord, when you tell me to move back to a country where I don't speak the language, I don't have a job, and my mother's telling me that this is not the will of God, I'll say yes, Lord. Lord, when you're telling me to quit my job and go back to school to study to help build the work, yes, Lord. This is what we're saying. And evangelist is right. If you're going to sing these songs, you better sing them with purpose, with intent. It means if you're singing these songs, you mean, you have in mind, so you have an understanding of what you're saying, and you actually mean to carry it out. Church, people will lead you and stay in church, so if you don't mean to sing these songs, then don't sing them. Please, please. If you don't mean it, don't sing it. No one will look at you anyway. Maybe not in this house, maybe other places they will. But no one will look at you anyway, because you know what? If you're going to sing these songs, you've got to sing them with purpose. Amen. Otherwise, don't bother sing, because you are making a vow. Yes, Lord, yes, to your will. He says, when your spirit speaks to me. So in other words, when your spirit, the Bible says the word, his words are spirit and they are life. So it's not just the Lord speaking to you directly. It means whatever's in the word and whatever, you know, the man of God or the leader that God has placed under you is directing you to do. When your spirit speaks to me with my half heart, with three quarters of my heart, which is the parts of my heart that are willing and that only like the parts that I want. With my whole heart, I will agree. In other words, I will concede to doing what it is. You know, we sang that song today, forward still is Jehovah's will. Even though the billows are dashing, that's not a clause for you to get out of God's purpose for your life. Even though you're being shipwrecked and stoned and ridiculed, and even though everybody has deserted you, that's not a reason to give up the purpose that God has placed in you. Why? Because forward still is his will. Even come no matter what. You must go forward. If you took that vow, you've got to go forward. But that profundity of that song is as he says, with a conquering tread, we will push ahead. But the miraculous is that when we push ahead, when we've given that yes, and we intend to do whatever it takes to accomplish the intention that God has placed in us, when we push ahead, he will roll the seas away. How about you this morning? Why are you here? Why are you here? Why am I here? This is the question that we should not give sleep to our eyes until we get an answer. Even if we only understand what our purpose is, as we said on prayer on Wednesday night, even if I only understand what my purpose is for today, even if I only get what I'm supposed to do for today, then let me get that and do it. And then should the Lord give me tomorrow, then I'll seek him, just even if it's just for that day, to understand my purpose. What am I supposed to accomplish today? For today is the day of salvation. You know, sometimes we're worried, and I believe that's sometimes why the Lord doesn't give us the whole vision at once, because if we really saw what God had purpose for us to do, we'd be like, me? Who? No, Lord Jesus, you got the wrong man. But day by day, line upon line, precept upon precept, here a little, there a little, he gives us what we need, just enough to push us forward, just enough light for the step that we're on, so that we know that there's something ahead, even though we can't see it, we know that there's something ahead, that if we just push past our fears, push past our own desires, push past our own will, and do what he said. We know when we'll stand and look back, we say, yes. I don't know about you, but I want that kind of confidence that Paul had. Shipwreck? Check. Preach to the Gentiles? Check. Stand before great men? Check. Imprisoned? Check. You know, lost, criticized and ruled against, imprisoned by my own countrymen? Check. Preach the gospel to the Gentiles so that in the space of 2 years, all of Asia knew. Whether they accepted it or not, they knew. Check. Lord, anything else? Good. I'm done. That's the kind of confidence that we've got to have. And in closing, you know, something John the Baptist, I remember my mom one time when she was here, she was, you know, asking the question, seeing how when John the Baptist was in prison, how Jesus never came to visit. Like, this, you know, this is family, you know? You're in prison, you know, the Bible says, when I was in prison, you didn't come visit me. So she's like, well, Jesus, how come John was in prison, you didn't visit him? He said, because John knew his purpose. And so when his purpose was accomplished, step out of the way. what fear have I have death? Say, Lord, listen, you told me to pave the way. I've done it. What more is there for me to do? Unless you have something else that you haven't told me, then it's on you, because if you didn't tell me, I don't, you know, if I asked you, if I did what you told me to do, then I have nothing to fear. And that's the kind of confidence that comes when you understand your purpose. Church, it is of an eternal importance that we understand our purpose. This is not just this, you know, shoulda, coulda, be something nice, you know, if I happen to know. No, we've got to know. And, you know, lately we're going to a lot of funerals, and people have this tendency to put people in heaven, say, oh, yes, you know, they're baptized in Jesus' name, fill the Holy Ghost. That's great, but that's not enough. It's great, but that's just the beginning. Paul said, move on to perfection. And perfection is doing what God has given you to do. We've got to. None of us should leave this house today without understanding, even if just to know what the purpose is for the rest of this day. And if you don't know what your purpose is, start with what you do know. Because the Bible says to tell us, all of us, to go out into all the world and preach the gospel. So if that's all you know, start with that. And if you start in obedience to what God has already told you to do, he'll take you the rest of the way. But you've got to start in obedience. Search me, O God, and know my heart, I pray.
Try me, O Savior, know my thoughts today. See if there be some wicked ways in me. Cleanse me from every sin and set me free. Search me, O God. Every one of us has got a purpose-driven life. Bless the Lord. And are we sitting on the purpose that God has given unto us? We just come, bless the name of the Lord. We sing the songs because the tune is good. But are we thinking of what the word is saying unto us? Are we fulfilling what the word is saying unto us? Are we being obedient? Bless the name of the Lord. We are all found guilty this morning. And we just want to ask the Lord to help us that we can fulfill the plan and the purpose that he has given to us. As God's woman servant has admonished us today, let us know why we come to the house of God and know what is our purpose, that we can work on our purpose, that at the end we can hear, well done, thou good and faithful servant. He has to search us because he knows all about us. We must be flexible in God's hand. And when we surrender our will, he will work upon us. God bless you today as we take these words into consideration. Go forward in the strength of the Lord. Our Lord God and Savior, hallelujah. King of kings and Lord of lords. The mighty God, the everlasting Father. Oh, blessed be the rock of our salvation. You who know our down sitting and our uprising. God, here we are before you at this moment. We are weighed in the balance, good God, and we are found wanting. In the name of Jesus today, help us, Lord. to accept and to acknowledge that we need you, good God Almighty, to help us to surrender totally our will, and that God will walk in the precepts and the guideline to fulfill the purpose, Lord have mercy, that you have given to us. Give full time, attention, quality time to do the will of the Most High God. Lord, today, help us not to be weary, for this journey is a long journey. What the songwriter said, must I empty-handed go? Must not I have one soul with me to greet you? Oh, Lord Jesus Christ, my Savior, let us consider our ways. Let us consider our doings, that God, we can win one soul. Lord God, to come from the ruined field of sin. Mighty God of Daniel, we are all called, Lord Jesus Christ. Every one of us have the ability, because God, you is dealing. You has given us the Holy Spirit to guide us. Mighty God, to be soul winners. Today we are broken up before you because we have been found wanting. We are weighed in the balance and we are found wanting. Help us to amend our ways. Put away, God, every evil of our doing. Reach out after righteousness. Serve you, Lord, knowing that everything on this side will remain. But when we have a good dose of salvation, it will take us to eternity. We thank you, Lord, for the message. We thank you for the messenger today. Ever guide her in the pathway. Help her, Lord God, to humble herself and to stay at your feet. Bless everyone under the sound of my voice today. Remember, Lord God, your manservant and his family. We pray, divine Lord God, that you'll cover him. Oh, glory to God and the family. You know his struggles, Lord God, but you have called him. Mighty God, he has a great responsibility. Lord, sometimes he may be thinking, God, but I pray for him today that you will give him the strength, that you will give him the courage, that you will give him the endurance. Mighty God, that he will hold on, be never weary. Lord God, for you have called him. Oh, glory to God for such a time of this to bring man back to you. Oh, God, that is his Lord plan. That is your plan for his life. Cover everyone again under the sound of my voice. Lord, you cover us today. And as we shall leave this place, in the name of Jesus, we go in your strength, trusting fully in you, because you are a rock in a weary land and you're a shelter to your people. We thank you today, oh God, my Savior, for what you have done. Mighty God, we're leaving this place today, taking a second thought, Lord Jesus Christ, asking ourselves a question. How are we standing? Are we making full proof of this ministry that you have given unto us? Father, hear my petition. Give us the strength. Bless today and cover everyone under the blood as we say thanks in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Our brother Cliff will come and pronounce the benediction in the name of Jesus. God's
blessing. Praise the Lord, saints. We raise our hands. May the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. May the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. No retreat.
No
surrender. No retreat. No retreat.
No surrender.
Amen, amen. You are dismissed in Jesus' name.